Namaste. Welcome
Namaste,
to yet another conversation in Atharva Forum. And today we have both an interesting topic as well as a very interesting personality. We are right in the middle of a pandemic where we are mulling over different medicinal practices through which we can have a control over this pandemic. And the country that we are in would have experienced perhaps, if not hundreds, thousands of pandemics in its vast age of the civilization. So the traditional medicine of our country is the topic of our conversation today. And I'm glad that today I have with me Dr. R. Geeta Sudhir, who wears multiple hats in terms of his qualification, because he's an MD in Siddha Medicine, a PhD, as well as a Verma expert. He holds diploma in Verma also. So welcome, Dr. Sudhir, to Atharva Forum. Let me begin by asking you, what are the different traditional medicine practices that we have in our country today?
Most of the, places, as in even in Tamil Nadu or Kerala or any of the states or any of the geographical location, will have their own traditional practices. It's like if you go to any separate place, they'll have a specific own traditional practices based on the available raw materials or based on the plants what are available there or based on the minerals that are available there. But as in with the proper recognition and everything, I would say there is only very few. It's been grouped under Ayush. I hope you know the acronym for the Ayush, A-Y-U-S-H. That is, the A stands for Ayurveda, Y for Yoga, U for Unani, S for Siddha, H for Homeopathy. Okay, so only these systems were recognized by the government of India, apart from the mainstream system of medicine, which is allopathy system of medicine. So among this, the five systems, Ayurveda and Siddha are the traditional, that is the indigenous medical system belonging to the Indian origin. Whereas the Unani, it came from the Persia before 400 years during the Mughal invasion. And the homeopathy, it came from Europe before 200 years. But both these system of medicine actually competed with the traditional Indian system of medicine. And then they got incorporated into the main health stream. That is why it's been now acknowledged one of the main system of medicine in as per the government of India. And apart from that, you also have this yoga. Yoga is actually part of both the tradition. Yoga is a part of Siddha and also it's a part of Ayurveda too. So it's not actually a standalone system, but government of India recognized this as a very standalone system of medicine. Okay. So among this, I would say Ayurveda is quite popular among all through the India. But whereas Siddha is very much popular only among the Tamil speaking community. And there is a Siddha college in Kerala also. And there are few Siddha centers in Karnataka too. And one Siddha center in Andhra Pradesh. So it's like only in the southern part of India, Siddha is quite popular. But when you look into the history of this, why you have different divisions? Because when you consider Siddha and Ayurveda, both the system of medicines are very much similar. Again, I repeat, it's similar, but they are not identical because both the system have their own uniqueness and own differences. But here, the point is, they actually follow or they accept few of the concepts which are very similar. Example, a body concept, that is, and dosha concepts and everything. Both the system accepts that. So it may look very similar, but actually they are like, they have their own uniqueness in their own way. When you want to know the exact differences between everything, we'll have a little bit history of it. Because when we were under the colonial rule, up to in the first two decades of the 20th century, the Indian traditional systems were not given more importance. It's like initially the British, they followed the Western biomedicine. And what they did is like, the Western biomedicine is available only to the colonial people and the people who are working under them. But after the World War, it's like they were not able to afford this. Western biomedicine to every people. So they just need to make use of the traditional medicine that is available at their colonial nations. So that is the time when the British got interest towards the traditional system of medicine. And initially what happened in 1921 or 223, a committee was formed by the Muhammad Usman as a head. This Muhammad Usman is a Yunani physician who is well expertise in English and also Sanskrit. So the purpose of this committee is they framed actually few questions, and that few questions has to be answered by the different traditional systems that is found all around the Indian subcontinent. So what happened in the sense, the people from different geographical locations and different languages, they gave their proposals. I mean, they gave their experiences and they gave their answers to those questions that has been asked by the particular committee. And among this, Tamil response was quite more. Ayurveda, which is a Sanskrit-based response, they were also in a very significant amount. And apart from that, they also had few responses in Telugu and Malayalam and also in different languages. But unfortunately, only the traditional system of these two languages got a different identity because of the two main reasons. Because the Siddha got its identity based on this Dravidian background and the influence of the Justice Party at that time. Similarly, the Ayurveda, I mean, apart from this, all the traditional medicines were grouped and been described as in the name of Ayurveda. But even from that point of time, there are a lot of debates, there are a lot of differences and between the both. Because at one point of time, the people from Kerala claimed that the Kerala Ayurveda is something different from the normal general Ayurveda, what they practice. Because the basic reason is like, each and every geographical location will have their own uniqueness. Uniqueness here, I mean that availability of the raw material and the cultural practices, what they follow, which are really very much depend on the climatic conditions. So, I mean, the one system of medicine cannot be just applied to all the geographical locations or something. So based on the geographical locations and the climate and the available raw material, each and every system, I mean, it will evolve over a period of time. But unfortunately, at that time, when the Usman committee was formed and it's been asked to just analyze how better this Indian system of medicine is, it was able to give only these two systems as the main system. The one is the Siddha and the other one is Ayurveda. And initially, the name Siddha was not given to the Siddha system of medicine. Initially, it's been named as the Tamil Ayurveda, because this Ayurveda, this particular term is applied to any system practice that gives health benefit. So even this Ayurvedam, the particular term is there in Thirukkural, which is a very old literature in Tamil. But there it means not the Ayurvedic system of medicine. It actually here means the health practices what they follow. Over a period of time, most of the literatures that were claimed to be the Ayurvedic literatures are in Sanskrit. And they have, I mean, that forms the main part of Ayurveda. But whereas the Siddha, the literatures were mostly in Tamil. There are few literature which are in Telugu too, and in few literatures are there in Malayalam too. So after that, after the Usman committee, what it did is like, okay, the traditional systems are able to address this particular questions, as in the questions that has been asked by the committee, and it recognized it to be the standard system of medicine, but it actually advised few modifications in that. That is basically the institutionalization of the particular medicines has to be done. So it also suggested to write the books as in the form of a print media, because before that, they don't have any print media books for the either system of the medicine. Because most of the text what they have will be in the palm leaf manuscripts. And there are a lot of people who worked on that. And especially in Tamil syllabuses and everything has been framed and few books were released. And this actually happened even before the independence. So what happened is like after the independence, they were institutionalized in a very clear way. That is, the course was framed and it's been fixed. That is, they have to supposed to undergo few examination type of things. And when it's been institutionalized, the basic, initially it was taught based on the Gurukula basis. Okay, that is, the particular guru has to select his student. And initially what happened, before start teaching the particular student, the guru has to observe him for a minimum of 12 years. And only then he'll start teaching him. And the teaching period will be very short, probably between some 6 months to 2 to 3 years. But for teaching for this short period of time, the guru will take more than 10 years to understand how the student is, and only then he'll start teaching. But this Gurukula basis has been changed to the institutionalized basis of teaching. And that is the place where they faced a lot of issues. And after they have been institutionalized, only the few system of medicine, that is Siddha and Ayurveda, got the recognition from the government of India, and they are quite popular now.
With that introduction of discussing the various traditional medicine practices and dwelling into the history and even how the term Siddha had come, I would like to move on and ask you, what are the general differences between the what we today recognize in the mainstream as the Western English medicine or the biomedicine and our traditional medicine in general, and particularly Siddha medicine? So can you highlight the basic differences between these two streams of medicines?
Okay. So actually, fundamentally, both the traditional system of medicine and the allopathy system, that is the Western bio system of medicine, is entirely different based on many aspects. Maybe we'll start from the how they approach a disease, or how a disease has been diagnosed, how a disease is approached. That is how a disease is diagnosed in an allopathy system is based on the various parameters what they analyze, as in you do a blood test, or you do any of the imaging techniques, or you do any of the protein extraction techniques and find that, okay, see, this protein level is high, or in this blood, this parameter is high, so you are considered to be diseased. That is how Western biomedicine address or identify a disease. But this is quite different in case of the traditional system of medicine, because almost all the traditional system in general, and Siddha in particular, recognizes the disease as anything which is actually disturbing the normal life activities of this particular person. I mean, here they say that the disease is something which actually interrupts your activity. So it is not something which, like, you have an elevated parameter, or you have an elevated blood levels or any of the things. It actually states that how your host responds to a particular cause. It's not that, as per the traditional system, the disease is not due to the exact cause. It is actually due to the how your body responds to the cause. That is why it's like it is more of an individualized part rather than the just generalized part. For example, what here I say is like, you take 10 people and you diagnose all them to be having diabetes. But when you start analyzing them, among these 10 people, say everyone have a fasting blood sugar value of more than 300. But among these 10 people, when you clinically observe, only some 4 to 5 people will have really the problematic aspect of that. As in other 5 to 6 people, they'll have an elevated blood sugar level, but actually that doesn't interrupt their activity at all. They'll be able to sleep well, and they won't have they don't have to get up frequently during the nighttime to urinate, or they don't have any tiredness, or they don't have any loss of weight, or they don't have any frequent infections or something. So that is the difference between how a traditional system approaches a disease and a Western bio system approaches a disease. So Western medicine approaches the disease mostly based on the parameters, the blood parameters or anything. But here, traditional system, it approaches the disease purely based on the your body's response to the cause. Any infection you can take. So if you take an infection, how the Western medicine differentiates the infection is like they'll identify the causative factor. So basically, the microorganisms, they'll group into different types, fungus, bacteria, virus, or a protozoan, or any other organism that causes a disease. In allopathy, they call it as a germ theory. That is, you get an infection if you get exposed to a particular germ. That is a theory what Western medicine follow. But the traditional medicine follow a different aspect. What it says is like how your body responds to the particular germ, or how your body responds to the particular cause. Because, for example, you take some 10 people and expose them to the same quantity of bacteria or virus in a same environment. among these 10 people, only few will get infected. And few may get a very severe infection, and a few people may not get the infection at all. The reason here is like the host response of one person to the particular organism is different, whereas it is the other person to that particular organism is different. So the traditional system, it actually clearly differentiates that. So what it says is like, see, the medicine or the characterization of the disease is purely based on how your host responds to the cause. It is not based on the cause. That is why they don't differentiate the disease as this is a causative organism, so this is the disease. So all the classifications in Siddha or in Ayurveda will be purely based on the Vata, Pitta, Kapha or the expressions what they make. So because this Vata, Pitta, Kapha is something which is like a personalized medicine. That is, it basically, it is a tool that has been used to understand the host response. So probably a Vata host will respond in a different way, or a Vata Pitta host will respond in a different way. So that way we characterize the disease and we address that. So this is a very major difference in terms of how Western medicine approach a disease and how traditional medicine approach a disease. How a Western medicine works is like the particular drug will have one or few molecules, maybe maximum some 2 to 3 molecules. For example, if you take a paracetamol or if you take any of the painkillers, it may have an acetyl salicylic acid in the particular specific concentrations. So when you take that particular drug, that particular molecule will interrupt in a particular cell signaling pathway, and so that you will have an immediate effect. So what happens is like this particular Western biomedicine, it actually gives you a particular molecule or a few molecules in a high concentrated amount. So that particular molecule will give you an instant effect. That is, it will immediately interrupt the pathway and it will give you an instant effect. But whereas when you take any of the traditional drugs, either it can be of plant origin or it can be of animal origin or it can be of metallic origin. So this particular drugs will have a multiple number of molecules. For example, a particular plant will have a minimum of some 50 to 100 phytochemicals in it. It can be an essential one or it can be a non-essential one. But all these phytochemicals will have a synergetic activity, but all the phytochemicals are in very minute quantities, not in a very huge quantities. So it's like they have a synergetic effect. It's not that. That is why in most of the cases, the traditional medicine doesn't show you an instant response, but it will have a very clear response. I mean, though it is quite a long-term response, it will give you a complete cure rather than the immediate quick relief. So that is a major difference in terms of the drugs what they use. Then I'll move on to the mode of approach for the treatment. I mean, how it's been treated. I'll take an example to explain that. Maybe if a particular person is suffering from fever, and the doctor decides that this particular fever is due to infection and it is not due to any other inflammatory cause or any other autoimmune cause. So if the doctor thinks, I mean, if an allopathy doctor thinks that, okay, this particular cause for fever is due to infection, what he'll basically what they give is like they give an antipyretic. Antipyretic is a term that represents a drug which immediately brings down the fever. Okay. And they also give a antibiotic. Antibiotic is something like which actually kills the bacteria. And they also give an antacid. Antacid is something which given to protect your intestine so that you're taking two other drugs which actually may damage your intestine. So this is the standard protocol what has been followed in the Western system of medicine. But when you just look into the actual pathophysiology of fever, fever is actually immune response. As in your body raises your temperature so that the organism which has invaded your body will have a unfavorable condition for its multiplication. So it's like when you are getting exposed to any of the microorganism, immediately your body will rise your temperature. So here, when in an allopathy approach, when you give any of the antipyretic immediately, what happens? It brings down your temperature. So here, a favorable condition for the growth of the organism has been created. So what happens, you know, in very small infections, I mean, if it is not a very severe infection, so if the fever has been brought down, the particular patient will feel comfortable. and your body will work to just defend the disease with other mechanisms like other inflammatory mediators and everything, and it will defend it. But if the infection is very severe, especially in case of pandemics or any of the other diseases like dengue, malaria and everything, the infection will be very severe. So at that cases, if you are just bringing down the fever immediately, the infection will keep on progressing until unless you address them with the exact antimicrobial stuff for that particular organism. And one more thing, the antibiotic is something very specific to the bacteria. It doesn't work on virus, or it doesn't work on fungus or any other protozoan or any other organism. But when you diagnose a person with fever, immediately the drug of choice will be any of the antibiotic. That is the practice what we have in India now. So here, again, what happens, you know, this antibiotic, though it doesn't kill the actual cause for the organism. For example, if you got a viral infection and the doctor is prescribing you an antibiotic and an antipyretic, so your fever will come down. Okay, you feel okay, I'm happy, I'm, because I'm feeling better now. And this antibiotic will actually kill the common microbiota, that is the bacteria which are good for your health, in your intestine. So again, you lose the basic immune response that has been generated by that particular bacteria. And again, you're also creating the favorable condition for the virus. So what happens in the sense, the virus will keep on multiplying and the disease will keep on progressing. And again, daily, you are maybe 3 times a day, if you are taking a paracetamol or any antipyretic, you don't even realize that your disease is progressing. Because once you take the paracetamol, it will have its effect for a short period of time. Because most of the time, these antipyretics are also, they are also analgesic. So you don't feel the pain. So you always feel comfort. So when the allopathy system, they uses this, so it's like their approach is like more like a quick relief. And your body has to repair on its own. That is what they believe in. So that is the reason for non-bacterial infections. Because for bacterial infections, they'll give an antibiotic and it will work fine. But for non-bacterial infections like virus, fungal or protozoal, the allopathy system of medicine, they struggle a lot because they don't have a very specific medicine to address each and every organism. As you know, the virus will keep on mutating, and fungus also, it, depending on the host, it will keep on evolving. So it's like even if they find a particular drug for the particular virus, within a year that it will evolve and you have to search for the another new drug for that. So as far as the bacteria is concerned, it's fine. Present allopathy system of medicine is able to address that. But if it comes to a non-bacterial infection, it really struggles a lot. That is the case with almost all the infections, either this COVID or dengue or any other infections, what we face in recent, the H1N1 and everything. So this is, this place, how the traditional system differs is more important. Because as I have already told, the traditional system doesn't treat based on the cause. Whereas it treat based on the host response, as in how your body responds to the host. So that is why here, based on, because as per the traditional system, the Kabadehi was considered to be more immune. So he don't get an infection very easily. So for example, if a particular person feels that he has got an infection, and when I examine him, I found that, okay, he has he's a Kaba dominated individual. And I feel that, okay, he's quite an immune person, then I don't have to give him a very strong drug or something to defend it. So in this case, I can just understand his, understand his host, and I can prescribe the drug accordingly. It's like just to adjust the host. What I mean here is like most of the traditional drug, it doesn't kill that particular virus or bacteria. But instead, it helps your host to fight against it. That is why most of the traditional drug, it doesn't bring down the fever immediately. So either it is like Sudarshana Churna as in Ayurveda, or it is like Nilavembu Kashayam or Kabasara Kudinir in Siddha. So none of these drugs will immediately bring your fever down. But instead, it actually relieves the complication of the fever. Relieves the complications here, I mean that, when you get a fever, you will have a body pain and you won't be in a position to do your normal work. But when you take these medicines, you will get relief from these kind of complications and you will be in a position to work. And in the same time, your body will also keep on fighting against the disease. And this also helps your body to fight against that. So what I feel is like this is a primary huge difference between both the Western system and also the traditional system in terms of these three. It's like maybe in the how they approach a disease and how the drugs are and how it's been treated.
How is the performance of modern Western medicine in this current pandemic that we are witnessing and experiencing?
Modern medicine is actually trying to address this disease in different forms, because COVID is a disease which have a very different type of presentations. What I say mean by here presentation is like how it's been clinically expressed, because the problem is some persons comes you with without any symptoms or with a very mild symptoms like throat irritation, cough or body pain and very mild symptoms, and some persons present you with a problems associated with the respiratory tract or even with the pneumonia or even with the collapsed lung, and few persons report to you with only diarrhea. I mean, they'll have only the gastrointestinal symptoms and they don't have any other symptoms at all. And even I have come across people who doesn't show any major symptoms at all except the tiredness and everything. So, you know, we have the various presentations. So the bottom line here is like, as the clinical presentation of this particular disease is like very diverse, you can't just stick on to the single mode of treatment or a single drug for this. As I have already told, the modern medicine work in the germ theory, as in what they work is like, if you want any of the particular drug to be effective in a particular infectious disease, that particular drug has to kill the particular organism. Only then they consider that, okay, this particular drug is authorized to treat this particular disease. That is what they follow on. Unfortunately, they don't find any of the drug with that. So initially, what the modern medicine did, I mean, as in under the WHO, what they did is like, they have just tested for most of the drugs which have already been in use for this kind of similar clinical manifestation. So most of the viral disease will have the fever with chills and the body ache and everything. So initially, the chloroquinone was the hot topic. It's like most of the allopathy physicians also recommended that, and few of the institutions recommended that, okay, hydroxychloroquinone may help in curing the or in management of this COVID. But later they came to know, okay, this was not very much effective. And then, still now they are using azithromycin. Azithromycin is actually an antibiotic. So as I've told you earlier, antibiotic is something which have a response only in bacteria. But still, in India, even the government of India for recommended protocols advise the usage of the azithromycin. The reason what they have given for that is like, once you get COVID, your immunity may be weak and the chances of getting any of the opportunistic bacterial infections is high. So they say that in order to prevent the opportunistic bacterial infections, we are giving azithromycin, which is actually a generalized explanation, but again, we don't find any clinical relevance to that, but still it's in practice now. And what practice they do here is like, they actually tried almost all kind of medicines. They have tested with the anti-parasitic medicines and any anti-flu medicines that have been initially in use for Japanese encephalitis or any of the influenza type of viruses. Even that has been in trial in many of the cases. And after this chloroquinone, that is an anti-malarial drug, they actually focused on most of the anti-HIV drugs, because they state that both are viruses and they share some commonalities. And what they did is like, they almost trialed all the anti-HIV drugs that were in pipeline, but unfortunately none of the anti-HIV drugs also worked. So at present, the protocol what they follow is like, basically we divide the disease into three stages. The one is the incubation period, the other one is viremic phase, and the next one is the inflammatory phase. So in incubation period, you can't say whether the particular person is diseased or not. In case if he's identified by the regular swab test or something, the government advises to give the supplements. The one is a zinc supplement And if his vitamin D is low, they'll advise to take vitamin D supplements and also the multivitamin supplements like C and B. Okay. If his vitamin D is not very low, then they'll stop on with the zinc and the multivitamin supplement. And if he is in the next phase, that is a viremic phase, is the phase where he starts getting fever and body aches and everything. At that stage, at present, the protocol that has been followed in India is azithromycin and antipyretic, that is a paracetamol or dolo 65 or whatever the doctor prefers. So this is in the viremic stage. When the doctor feels that the particular person is moving from the viremic phase to the next inflammatory phase. Inflammatory phase is the phase where the virus has been dispersed in your, initially what happens, the virus will infect a particular cell and then it multiplies within the cell and it produces the millions of copies of it. And then these millions of copies will be dispersed. The inflammatory phase actually happens when your body started fighting against this particular dispersed viruses. So, you know, a lot of the inflammatory mediators will be released and the antibodies will be released. And these inflammatory mediators, apart from killing the viruses, will also damage your own system, especially your blood vessels and also few organs. And this is purely based on the genetic makeup and what kind of food culture they follow. Because at least from my experience, what I have seen is like, I have seen people reporting absolutely normal or with a very mild symptoms in the day two or three. But within some 3-4 days, they'll completely collapse. As in, they'll have a severe pneumonia or they'll have any of the organ failure or something. So we were wondering how this disease progressed within this short period of time. This is purely based on their genetic background. So what happens, what this Western system or allopathy system do is like, they'll keep them under monitoring. So when they feel that even after giving this paracetamol or azithromycin during this viremic phase, when the particular person is in the viremic stage, they'll give this antipyretic and an antibiotic. So if the particular person doesn't respond to that, in most of the cases, he doesn't respond. And now they also use the remedies for at this stage, in the viremic stage. So if he didn't respond, the disease will keep on progressing. So the response here, I mean, in 60-70% of the cases, what happens, you know, the particular person's body itself will be able to fight against the disease. And he'll and only support what these medicines give is like a comfort at that time. But in few cases, as in some 30% of the cases, if he is not responding to the medicines, he'll proceed to the inflammatory phase. So when the person starts proceeding to the inflammatory phase, the only option they have is a steroids. So they'll initially start with a methylprednisolone at a particular dosage. If the person is not responding at the particular dosage, then they'll proceed to the they'll keep on increasing the dosage. So if the patient is, and maybe the other supports like oxygen support or any other external support he needs will also be provided. And if the patient is not responding to any of the medications, then you don't have much choice there, as in you don't have any other drug of choice. The only thing they have to depend on is like they have to immediately manage the hyperimmune response and the inflammation that is happening in your body. And if that is not, that could not be managed by the anti-inflammatory drugs, then the survival of the patient will be very difficult. And one more problem associated with this COVID is the vasculitis. Vasculitis is the inflammatory reaction that is happening in your blood vessels. That is the reason for the most of the lung infiltrates and everything. When your lungs gets involved, the reason, in at least in COVID, is like you'll have a vasculitis in all the alveolar capillaries. And that results in the damage to those capillaries and your lung won't be able to function efficiently. And again, this is also quite a confusing statement here, because what I mean confusing here is like, usually the diagnosis of the damage to the lungs is done by the CT scan. which actually says that, okay, among the five lobes of the lungs, how many lobes are affected and how much percentage of each and lobe is affected. That is what the CT scan gives. But I have seen few patients who have a lung damage of more than 60% and still they'll be very normal, as in they don't feel dyspneic or they don't feel any other symptoms associated with the respiratory deficiency. And I have also seen patients with very minor lung involvement, but with a very high clinical presentation. High clinical presentation here, I mean, is like they'll have a lung involvement of less than 20%, but still they'll have a very high respiratory rate and they'll feel breathing difficulty and everything. So the modern system struggle what they are facing is like due to this diverse presentation. It's like it's not a disease with a very small number of symptoms or a very concrete similar presentation. So you have a disease with a diverse presentation, and this diversity is basically due to the response of the particular host to that particular cause. At present, that is why the modern system of medicine, that is allopathy system of medicine, is finding it very difficult to address the people, especially the people who are not showing response to the treatment. As in, if they are showing response at the initial stage, then okay, it's fine, they'll be recovered. But if they did not show any response at the initial stage, then they have only very few options to treat them.
With that overview of how the Western medicine is handling the current pandemic, which clearly seems to be that they do not have many options, except for if the patient is able to fight the virus by himself or herself.
Exactly.
That brings to the next portion, is that how does the traditional medicine of our country in general, and in your experience, how Siddha handles, is capable of handling this current pandemic, that is COVID-19?
Okay. So first, let me say one point very clear, sir. Siddha system of medicine is something which has its deep root in the Tamil culture. So whenever a pandemic or whenever a disease outbreak is seen, we have a cultural practices that actually gives you really a very good protection. I'll give two examples here. The one is the Pongal festival. Hope you know about the Pongal festival. It is a harvest festival that has been practiced in Tamil Nadu. So usually this festival is celebrated in the month of January, because, you know, in month of January, and what are the practices they follow in the Pongal festival is like, they'll clean all the houses. I mean, for example, if you take a village, in village, what they do is like all the houses will be cleaned, because the Pongal is a festival that will be celebrated for a period of 4 days. The first day is called as Bogi, in which they'll clean all the clean and they'll burn all the unwanted things, stuffs. And the whitewashing of the house will be done with the sunnamba, which is the calcium carbonate. The next day is like Matu Pongal, which is Pongal is specific for the cattle. So what they do is like they'll just clean their cattle, they'll just decorate their horns, and they'll also prepare a special kind of pongal, and they'll offer it to the cattle too. So cattle here, I mean all the domestic animals which the village people used to have in their house. So then the next day is like a Kanum Pongal, in which they go to the different places like the natural river and everything, the nearby water sources, and they'll have a special celebration on that. The purpose of here is like even the particular natural resources will also be cleaned and preserved. So here what I mean is like this is a festival that has been practiced, that is in practice for a long time at the month of January. This at the month, because, you know, after this February and March is the season where the summer begins. So this is a season where you will get all kind of viral disorders, as in chickenpox and now dengue, and all these viral disorders will be more common during this season. That is the March, April, from February it will start. So this practice is almost like cleaning an entire village. Cleaning an entire village here, I mean, is like, because, you know, they are cleaning their own houses first. and they are burning the unwanted things first. Then they are also making their cattle, taking care of their cattle and disinfect them with a special food what they provide to the cattle. And you know, during this pongal, they use two plants. The one is the neem leaves, the other one is in Tamil it is called as Sirigan Pilai. The botanical name of that is Arva Lineata. So that will be tied in their entrance and everything. So all these practices are the disinfectant measures. Culturally, what they do is like they are preparing themselves to face summer and the disease associated with the summer. So what I mean here is like this is for the general causes. But in case if a particular village is facing a particular disease. So in Tamil Nadu, there is a female goddess called Mariamma. So let us say that one particular village is affected by any of the viral disorder or any of the infectious disorder. Immediately, they'll call for a festival. So what they do is like there is a particular custom called Kaapu Kattudal. So Kaapu Kattudal is like they'll tie a cloth that has been dipped in turmeric in their particular hand. Once this Kaapu Kattudal is done, none of the people from the village are allowed to move out of the village boundary. So this is a kind of quarantine that has been in the cultural practice for a long time. That is, once you identify an infectious disease in a particular village locality, they'll immediately call for a festival for this Mariamma and they do this Kaapu Kattudal. Once the Kaapu Kattudal is done, everyone will be quarantined within the village itself. And you know, during that time, I mean, during this particular festival time, if there is any death, the norms is like the particular final cremation ceremony should not be in groups. They also prepare various food like kambangul, which is a traditional food that has been prepared in Tamil Nadu, and also other different types of food. They'll offer it to the god and they'll distribute to the people. So this particular food items which they offer to the god and distribute to the people will also give immunity. These cultural practices clearly mean the quarantine practice we are following now. So it's like because everything has been said in the name of God, but even now it's been there in the practice. Even now in Tamil Nadu villages, if you get any of the infectious diseases, they'll call for the festival of Mariamma festival, I mean for the goddess Mariamma, and they follow all these kind of regulations. So here what I mean to say is like this is how the traditional system of traditional Siddha system that has been practiced by the Tamil speaking community is, this is how they have been following the quarantine and other basic methods to prevent the spread and the severity of the diseases. So apart from that, then they'll go for, only after that they'll go for specific medications and specific formulations for that. So here I just want to differentiate two things here, because in Tamil we call it as a Kai Vaidyam or Pati Vaidyam one. Then other thing is the professional medical system what we follow. This Kai Vaidyam or Pati Vaidyam here, what I mean is like managing a disease with the substances which you have in your house, like commonly used spices or anything. But this should not be confused with the Siddha system of medicine or any other traditional system of medicine, because traditional system is not just the system which is like, as in Tamil we say it as a Kai Vaidyam or Pati Vaidyam. Both Ayurveda and Siddha, they actually have a very detailed type of formulation. For example, Nilavembu Kashayam or something, you cannot just prepare, you cannot actually have all the raw materials in your home. That you have to collect it from different places and only then you can go for the preparation. Same with the Sudarshana Churna or any other drugs that has been prescribed by this, that has been used in Ayurveda. So when we come to the COVID, which is a very new disease to the human community. So here, how the traditional system of medicine is, playing its role here. So here what I suggest is, initially when the COVID was detected in China and then in few other countries, at that time India was free of COVID. The first case has been reported in January last, I guess. So from that time, at least in Tamil Nadu, they have started promoting the consumption of a particular Siddha drug called Kabasura Kudineer. which is actually a Siddha drug with 11 ingredients, and that has to be prepared. I mean, it's a decoction that has to be prepared then and off, and it has to be administered a minimum some 2 to 3 times a day, depending on the severity and everything. So this has been administered in a mass amount, as in almost the whole population has been asked to take this, and the government has taken a very effective step in administering all this Tapasura Kudini to door by door. And it's also been distributed in various institutions and various public places and everything. But again, what I feel here is, like, though the Tapasura Kudini has been promoted, most of the cases they have not followed the specific standard protocols for the preparation of the kashayam and also for the distribution of this. Because as they believe that it is an infectious disease, in few cases, the problem what they faced is, like, if you are administering a particular drug in a mass, as in this is a decoction, right? So it has to be distributed in any of the cups or tumblers. Few people claim that, okay, the chances of infections are more because the people are crowding here, and also the cross-contamination. As in, if you are giving the same cup to the other, the chances of infections are high. And there were a lot of criticisms. But a few papers has been published, one or two papers have been published, depending on the effect of that. So they showed some significant effect, actually. As in, what they have shown is, like, when this Tapasura Kudini was administered to initial stage, as in the asymptomatic stage, most of the people have recovered. The recovery rate is fine. But there is also no denial that few people, even after taking this initial drugs, will proceed to the next stage. So in my experience, I have come across the patients who are like asymptomatic and who are also very mild symptoms and moderate symptoms, and also who are very, very severe and critical. So here my suggestion is, like, if he is asymptomatic, maybe even the small decoction with 2 to 3 times a day will be fine. Either it can be a Nilavembu Kashayam, which is also a decoction made from other Nayan drugs, or Tapasura Kudini, or any of the decoction that has been advised for the fever. Here, I'll just give you a brief introduction about how the Siddha system actually addresses an infectious disease. So as I have already told, the classification of the disease in Siddha is based on the host response, not on the cause of the disease. Infectious disease has been grouped under the common symptom, which is fever, and in Tamil, it is called Suram, and they have grouped into 64 types. So among the 64 types, 52 types of fever are due to the external cause, whereas the 12 types are due to the internal cause. So 12 types due to the internal cause here mean that the fever that has been caused to any due to any autoimmune disorders or inflammation or any trauma or your psychological disturbances like that. But whereas 52 other types of fever due to the external cause, right? So that is, like, that is primarily based on your host response and body constitution. So this is more important when you approach a patient with a COVID or any infection, I would say. So here, among these 52 types, you have a lot of decoction that has been prescribed for different types of fever. For example, one patient may experience a constipation and a fever. The other patient may experience diarrhea and a fever in COVID, I'm telling you. And one patient may experience a respiratory symptom without any fever at all, whereas the other patient may experience high fever, but no respiratory symptom, but diarrhea. So, you know, this kind of diversity will be there. The classification of fever in Siddha terms actually differentiate that. It will take even the minute clinical difficulties into consideration. There are two different classifications, which differs only by the sleep pattern. I mean, if you have a very proper sleep, then they consider, or if you have a very extended sleep, then it will be considered as a one type of Suram. And if you have insomnia, that is, if you have a sleep disturbance, that will be considered as another type of Suram. So based on that, first initially, we have to classify that. So after that, we'll go for the medication part. So what I mean here is, like, if they have only mild symptoms or asymptomatic, we'll stop with the decoction itself. They don't need to be administered with any higher drugs or something, but they have to be under observation. What I usually do is, like, I usually ask them to just update about their health minimum once in 3 days or something, if they are asymptomatic or with the mild symptoms. when the patient start when the disease is start progressing and the patient is experiencing moderate symptoms. Moderate symptoms here I mean that fever with extreme body pain and tiredness. It means that he is in the viremic stage. So usually if the fever is not getting recovered within 7 days, then it is an alarming sign that he may proceed to the next inflammatory phase anytime. And as far as the COVID is concerned, cough is also a high alarming sign because initially the patient will experience a mild cough. The initial stages what he may experience is like he'll sleep well, but in between, probably if he sleeps at 10 o'clock, he may get up at 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock and feel that, okay, I'm getting a cough. He may cough for some 10 minutes and then he'll sleep again. The next day, the duration actually increases. Probably within 4 or 5 days, the cough will be in such a way that he can't even open his mouth. I mean, if he tries to speak, he'll get a cough. Or if he tries to lie down, he'll get a cough. So this is like this classical sign is experienced in approximately some 60 to 70% of cases. And there are also exceptional cases where the patient will have the pneumonitis even without cough. So that are also there. So what we do is like, so when the patient is reporting or presenting with the moderate symptoms, say fever for more than 5 days, and his respiratory rate is little more. The normal respiratory rate should be 16 to 18, but if he is reporting you with above 25, say 28, 29, then you have to be quite cautious and you group them under the people with the moderate symptom. And here I follow two steps. If I feel that the particular patient is very confident and he feel only the very less number of symptoms, I'll just increase the dosage of the decoctions. So for 1 or 2 days, and if the particular patient is not responding to that, then we'll have to move on to the higher drugs. Higher drugs here, I mean the drugs that are made of the metallic preparations. So because the theory what we follow is like initially you have to stick on with the roots, the plant-based drugs. And if it doesn't respond, then you have to proceed to the metal-based drugs. So here, if the patient is reporting you in a moderate state, then definitely you have to start with the metal-based drugs. And here, particularly, I use the mercury-based drug and also arsenic-based drugs. And again, I repeat that mercuric and arsenic based drugs, but they have been processed in a very tedious way. It's like for preparing a single drug will take you minimum some 3 to 4 weeks or even months. Okay, so it's a very huge process. So the processed drug I use here, and based on the reporting condition, the drug of choice also differs based on the patient's general body constitution and the time of presentation and also how confident he is. And one more factor what we consider here is like the caretaker also. Because if the particular patient has a very good caretaker, say, for example, if a particular lady feels that his mother is infected and this particular lady is taking a very good care of the mother, then we don't go for a very higher drug. Because here I mean that if the particular person is getting a very extreme care and with a very limited number of medications, he is showing a very significant response. And here if the particular person is reporting you with moderate symptoms and you can clearly see that there are a very, and he also have a very good caretaker, then we'll give the metallic drugs 2 times a day is fine. And depending on his comorbidities also, as in they may have a diabetes, they may have a hypertension, or they may have any renal disorders. So we have to decide based on that. So in moderate stage, I would say, at least in my clinical experience, I have seen almost 100% recovery. So there is people respond to the medicine drastically. So in case if the particular person is not responding to the particular medicine for 1 or 2 days, then we'll try the next medicine and he'll get recovered easily. And moreover, at moderate stage, what we advise us is Otradam. So Otradam is like, it's a fermentation technique. So how we do that is like, there are different methods of this fermentation. But the most efficient method is the one which we do with the castor seeds. You have to remove the seed coat. You will find a white colored pulse within it. And that has to be fried in the frying pan. And once it gets hot, you have to tie it in the cloth and you have to do the fermentation. So in case if this castor seeds are not available, we also advise to do the same fermentation with M sand. The M sand is the one which has been commonly used in the construction sites. So even that will also help. The fermentation has to be done continuously for 1 hour with 2 times a day. So this actually has shown a drastic result. What I have seen is like without this fermentation, the recovery rate is very slow. So then comes the next case, that is the severe cases. So severe cases, what I mean here is like those who have the respiratory rate of more than 40, that is they'll have a respiratory rate of more than 40. And this is a stage where they'll have the low saturation level, because up to moderate state, they'll have a saturation level of more than 94, 95. But when it comes to the severe state, they'll have the saturation below 90. And in most of the people, it will fluctuate between 80 to 90. One time they'll have 81, 82, and the maximum saturation they have will be around 90. So in this case, we have to be very cautious. So here, maybe you have to use multiple drugs. Not a single drug will work, because when a patient is reporting you with this condition, in most of the cases, he'll have a lung involvement of more than 50%. Almost all the lobes will be involved, so that his lungs won't be able to function properly and do this oxygenation properly. That is the reason your blood oxygen level will be low and he'll be having a difficult respiratory difficulty with breathlessness and everything. So at that time, we'll initially access and first we'll consider the age, then we'll consider the body constituent. If he is of Kapha Degi, then his chances of recovery are high. But if he is of Pitta Degi or Vada Degi, the chances of recovery are relatively low. So even at this point of time, we advise the fermentation for approximately 8 to 10 hours per day. That is because when your patient report to you in this condition, they won't be able to lie down, because when they try to lie down, they'll feel more dyspneic, as in more breathlessness, and their saturation will go down and they can't even lie down. But when you do this fermentation for 1 hour, they'll be in a position to sleep for some half an hour to 1 hour. So after that, they'll get up. Then again, you have to do the fermentation. So that is why I said if they have a very good caretaker, the chances of recovery are very high. We can clearly identify that, okay, he has a renal issues, and that has to be addressed in a different way, because especially if the particular person has a renal issues, it is very difficult to give him the higher order medicine, the one which is made from mercury or arsenic. So in that cases, you have to be very clear with the dosage and duration. It's the risk-benefit ratio, because you can't just avoid the drug, but it shouldn't be in such a way that it affects the kidney also. As far as the Siddha system is concerned, addressing the COVID actually involves both external therapy and also the internal therapy, because what the cases I have treated were not with the oxygen support. And maximum low saturation level, what I have seen is like from 75 to up to 85, the fluctuating levels between 75 to 85. But if the patient is reporting to me with the saturation level below that, as in say some 66, 67, then I'm sure that he needs an oxygen support. In my experience, I have managed one patient with the saturation level below 70. She was 82 years lady with a saturation of fluctuating between 63 and 68. But she was a very confident lady and she said, okay, I'm not ready to get hospitalized, or I'm not ready to get any oxygen support or something. You just give me the medicines, and if I survive, let me survive. This was a statement given by the lady. But surprisingly, she survived within, and her recovery is also very fast. As in within 7 days, she recovered, and her saturation returned to 91, 92 within 7 days. What I strongly say here is like, if you have a severe involvement and the saturation is between 75 and 85,
I am sure that Siddha can offer you a very good management in case of COVID.
It's a wonderful thing to know that Siddha is ready to offer solution to this management of pandemic. In which case, what makes me ask you is, what are the challenges that traditional medicine in general and Siddha in particular is facing in moving forward in managing this issue?
Okay. So when the COVID was first detected in India, even Prime Minister was having interactions with many of the traditional medicine experts on that. And what they have asked is like, okay, what are the medications you suggest? And then they asked, what is the base for suggesting the medications? So here, the point is like, as I have already told, the Western medicine is something which believes in germ theory. So they say that your medicine is effective only if this particular medicine kills the particular virus, or the, I mean, in case of COVID, it is virus. So all the initial preliminary steps have been done in such a way that any of the particular drug which we in the traditional system is actually killing the virus. All our preclinical studies, they are not clinical trials. I mean, it's been tested in the laboratory. And as far as I know, only very few animal studies have been done. Even that was also not in the successful rate. Because this is like, what I feel here is like, I mean, the two system of medicines are entirely different. They have a different mode of approach and they have a different treatment procedure. So it's like, I agree that allopathy system of medicine is the mainstream of medicine. But that doesn't mean that all the other system of medicine has to follow the exact rules that has been framed for the allopathy system of medicine. Because it's like, as far as the Siddha medicine is concerned, it is something which is related with the host response. If you want to work on the host response with the available tools now, it will be very difficult. Because if you want to work on the host response, you have to work on the different protein interactions that is happening in your body, which is really expensive, at least at this point of time. So that is like, that is not possible at all. So instead, what I suggest is like, if you want to really know the effect of this particular drug, the government has to promote or give the opportunity to the traditional experts to handle the moderate and severe cases with their drugs. Because it's like, as far as the COVID is concerned, both the allopathy system of medicine or any other system of medicine are in equal state. None of the system can say that, okay, I have a cure for that, or I have a claim for that. But, you know, a lot of the allopathy drugs that were in pipeline were allowed to undergo trials with them. This remdesivir or hydroxychloroquine or any other drug you can say. But none of the traditional drugs were allowed to perform this phase 2 clinical trial in any means. What I mean here is like, because the only statement for rejecting the trial is, see, you don't have any preliminary evidence. So preliminary evidence, again, here they mean is like, either you do some microbial testing or you do some animal testing and you give some preliminary evidence, which actually doesn't work. Because, you know, the entire mode of approach itself is different. So the government should be like, should have a broad mind to understand that first. It should understand that each and every system is different, and different rules has to be framed for each and every system of medicine based on the system's uniqueness and the philosophy which it follow. So, but this is, but at present, the scenario is very different, as in every system were forced to obey the rules that has been framed for the mainstream system of medicine. So I feel that only if this is changed, then the traditional system will be in a position to prove what are the efficacy, I mean, what are the efficient drugs they have. And one more thing, though the government says that, see, we are giving importance to the Ayush and everything, the allotment of fund is like very different. It's like the allotment of fund for the allopathy medications and the research for those allopathy medications is like very huge when compared with the funds that has been allotted to the traditional systems. So only if they find some equality in case of fund allotments for the system, only then the traditional medicine will have a choice to prove their efficacy.
That's a very wonderful note to know. And I guess with that, we have come to a close of this conversation. But what strikes me from this is that when even the Western biomedicine is grappling and kind of shooting in the dark to manage this COVID, there seems to be a lot of hopes from the quarters of traditional medicine, but which unfortunately, due to several socio-political moorings in our country, it is not getting either the attention that it's supposed to get, or it is not being followed. I'm only reminded of the analogy of electoral democracy. As one of our former prime minister had said, that in this democratic country of India, the access to the assets of the country is first to the minorities of the country. But when that is a logic applied there, I wonder why the traditional medicine, which today is kind of a minority in the medicinal field in our country, why that is not getting the prime importance or the prime following that it is ought to get, and which has remained, which has sustained the population of our country for a very long time, knowing that there are possible good possibilities of COVID management from the traditional medicine and particularly Siddha to offer. I thank you on my personal behalf and on behalf of Atharva Forum for having spared your time as well as your expertise and experience in handling COVID management to all our audiences. Thank you very much, Dr. Sudhir.